We're going to read two quick portions of scripture just to start. The first is in Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. Then if you want to also, it's kind of at the same time, open up to 2 Timothy 4. We're just going to read these two scriptures together. Matthew chapter 7, starting at verse 13, Jesus said, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few." And then in 2 Timothy chapter 4, starting at verse 3, this is the Apostle Paul. He says, "For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths." Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. And again, we thank you for how you are here with us today. Lord, that was the cry that I had this morning was, Lord, we don't just come here to sing songs or to hear messages. We come here to commune with the God of all creation. We come here because you are here. And we just ask that you would have your way over these next 40 minutes or so. We pray that you would open our hearts and that we would be humble before your word. And we ask that everything would glorify the name of Jesus. And we ask this in your name. Amen. Amen. Hey, you guys can be seated. Be sure to greet someone again as you sit. Thank you again, worship team, for leading us today. Again, I'm excited to be with you guys here. My name is Josh, and I'm one of the pastors here, and just thankful to be able to share, minister the Word of God. And if I've never had the chance to meet you, I would love the opportunity just to meet you after service, shake your hand, and hear what God's been doing in your life. I don't know if anyone else feels this way or if it's just me. If it's just me, this is going to be a little awkward, but I don't know if anyone else has felt this way, but it seems to me like over the last maybe 3 to 4 years, we have watched both maybe personally, individually, and maybe nationally, more people walking away from faith than at any time that I can remember. Now, I'm only 29, so I don't have the perspective that some of you have. And maybe it's just because of social media and the fact that anyone can have a YouTube channel and anyone can start a podcast and you can get your message out there. But it just feels like more than ever, we are watching people walk away from this incredible faith in Jesus Christ. I know me personally, Linda and I, we've had several friends and people that we've done ministry with that have either completely walked away from faith over the last couple of years or have redefined their faith. As you may hear it from time to time, they've deconstructed their faith and tried to rebuild something brand new, something that more fits their worldview. A popular term that you'll hear a lot is, "I'm an ex-evangelical. I no longer associate with the Christian faith that I grew up in." We've had several people that have walked down that path the last few years. And talking, we've got a young adult in college group that's been having some conversations along these lines. And many of them have shared the exact same story, that people that have grown up in the faith, been part of the faith, have walked away in these last couple of years. And then, if you're a little bit plugged in, you might know that even on a grander scale, a more national scale, there has been many, and I don't like to use this word, but you'll understand, more high-profile believers that have walked away from faith. Some have been pastors, some have been musicians, some have been writers, who over the last couple of years have either, again, walked away from faith completely or have begun to redefine their faith and reconstruct a faith that is more suitable to their desires. And when I read those two verses that we just read, the first thing that comes to mind, and I hope this doesn't sound cold, but that shouldn't surprise us. It shouldn't surprise us when people walk away or reject the gospel. Jesus told us, again in Matthew 7, that on a grand scale, the number of people that will follow him to the end will be far smaller than those who do not. Jesus made it very clear that the number of people that will reject him will far and away outweigh those who will embrace this incredible gospel. But then Paul even told us years later, he warned us that a day was coming. He was talking about those in the church, not just those who reject the faith outright, but those actually in the church. He said that a day was coming when there would be a great walking away. He said that a day was coming when people would not put up with the true gospel of Jesus Christ, that they would begin to redefine it, that they would begin to make it more palatable, that they would find teachers who would be willing to promote their personal worldviews rather than the true gospel message of Jesus Christ. And even Paul goes as far as to say, and they will begin to pursue myths. They will begin to pursue myths. And so it should not be surprising that we're seeing people walk away from faith. But what is concerning, what does grieve my heart, and I know grieves the heart of Pastor Kurt and our leaders, and again, some of the people I've had conversations with, what grieves our heart is obviously that they are walking away. We don't want to see anyone walk away, but what really is scary is the reasons that they're walking away. What's really scary is not even more than just the reasons they're walking away, but what they feel they're walking away from, how they defined the Christianity that they're leaving. And then even beyond that, the elements of their story that are missing, the elements of faith that are missing in their story. And I do my very best, and I challenge you to do the same, because it's so easy today with so much technology and different platforms. When you hear of people that are falling away, listen to their stories. Listen to what has happened. I've done my very best to try to listen to stories of those who have walked away from faith because, and I don't know if anyone, this resonates with you, and I hope this doesn't sound arrogant, but man, I love Jesus. I love Jesus, and when I hear of people walking away from him, I just can't understand. I'm like, how could you walk away from Jesus? Like, I understand why someone may walk away from a church. I understand why someone might, you know, walk away from a particular leader or something like that, or maybe, you know, they were turned off by something that happened in their church. I can understand that. I don't always think that those are great reasons, but at least I can understand. But walking away from Jesus, how could you walk away from the one who came to save and restore and redeem and has come to give us life and life more abundantly? When I hear of people walking away from Jesus, that I want to know. That I want to listen to. I want to understand what brought you. And you know, now again, there's so many different ways that you can hear. I was telling this to our young adult group not long ago that between YouTube, Instagram, TikTok, and all these different platforms, there are hundreds and hundreds of accounts that are literally dedicated to people's deconversion stories. And some of them just explain it, but then many of them mock Christianity. They criticize the evangelical church, and it is literally account after account of either just completely just coming against the Christian faith or, again, redefining the Christian faith. And, again, I was, over the Easter time, I was going through a lot of those stories, and, I mean, every one of these videos, 1 million watches, 2 million watches, you know, 1 million likes. And you realize that this is not just small fringe things that are happening. This is a movement that's taking place of walking away from faith. And so I do my very best to learn and to try to understand where people are coming from because I recognize that if it's happening that much outside of Bethel, there's a likelihood it could be happening inside of Bethel as well. And I recognize that I should never, as Jesus says, I should never be so prideful to think that those things could never happen to me if it isn't for the grace of God in my life. And so I want to learn and I want to understand how to help people and minister to people and answer questions in those seasons. And as you begin to listen to so many of these stories, you'll find a couple things. The first thing I find is that there is any number of reasons why someone enters into faith or finds themselves in a Christian community. You know, there's no one-size-fits-all. Some people are like me, and you were just born into this. Like, you were born into the church, and you never missed a Sunday, even if you were sick. Like, that is kind of the way it was. I remember when I first went away to school, when I went away to college, a lot of the churches that were near us didn't have Wednesday night services. You know, it just was, you know, but I grew up with Wednesday night services my entire life. And so the first Wednesday night when I was in my dorm room and we were playing, like, video games, I kind of thought I had to ask for forgiveness. I was like, I don't know if this is right or wrong, and I'm glad that we still have Wednesday nights because the more we can be in the church, the better. But again, some of you have that experience. You've just been in this all of your life. You've never known anything but the Christian faith. Some of you, or some of us, we've been invited to church, you know, a youth group, a college group, a small group, something like that. Some of us came to faith or we came into the church because of a crisis situation, and we just knew I don't have the answers on my own. I need to find, you know, people that do. I need to find someone that does. Or maybe you were just looking for community. You were looking for some people to do life with. And so there's a million reasons why we might end up in church. And there's also a million reasons why we might leave it. There's a million reasons why people walk away from faith. For some people, again, they grew up in it. It's all that they knew, but it was never real. They knew what to do. They knew what Christianity was about, but it was never more than just kind of going through the motions. And then when they finally got to a certain age, they realized, I don't really believe in this, so I might as well just kind of stop altogether, and their faith begins to dissolve. Some people, they only came into church because of a crisis. And then as soon as the crisis was over, there was no need for Jesus anymore. There was no need for faith. And then for others, maybe more seriously, some people just really encounter questions and doubts in their faith. Some things that they can't reconcile, some things that they don't understand. You know, especially Pastor Kurt was mentioning just how toxic the last 2 years have been. I mean, how many people have walked away from faith based on how their church handled COVID? Just being honest with you. Whether their church made them wear a mask, not wear a mask, whether their church decided to stay open or closed. How many people just walked away from faith because they didn't like the way their church handled things politically the last couple of years? You know, how many people didn't like? And then how many people just can't handle it when their personal worldview comes into collision with the Bible and the gospel? And they end up just elevating their worldview instead of coming under the authority of Jesus. And so there's a million reasons why someone may walk away from faith, how they enter into faith. All of that, you know, we could just make endless lists. But as you begin to listen to a lot of these stories, and my bet is that some of these might already be within us if we're not careful, is that there are two similarities in all of these stories. The first is, as you begin to listen to what people describe as what they're leaving, like what they are actually walking away from, you begin to hear kind of the same things. You begin to hear, well, I'm walking away from coming to church on Sundays. I'm leaving my Bible. I'm leaving praying. I'm leaving this Christian community. I'm leaving serving in this ministry. I'm leaving all the things that Christians do. I'm leaving all of the things that I think Christianity is about, but you'll never hear them say, I'm leaving Jesus. I'm leaving Christ, because for them, their faith never went beyond just Christian activity. For them, their faith had never gone beyond. It had never become what Christianity is all about, and that is a relationship with Jesus. For them, their Christianity has been completely defined by just doing what Christians are supposed to do. I went to kids' church. I went to youth group. I went to youth camp. I went to the small groups. I served in ministry. I was on the worship team. I went on a missions trip. And for them, that was their faith. That's how they defined it. But it never moved into what we sang about. It never moved into what we worship and what we celebrate every week, and that is Jesus. It's about a personal walk and relationship with Jesus. And that seems to be something that for many of them, that's not how they saw their faith. It was just activity. It was just doing what Christians are supposed to do. But there's a second similarity. And it's not so much something that happened to them, but maybe something that didn't take place. Something they didn't experience. Something that wasn't taught to them. And that is true, authentic, biblical repentance. A season, a time of repentance in their lives. You know, repentance, depending on the church that you attend, may or may not be a word that we hear very often. I'm very thankful, and I hope you are too, that we talk about repentance often, that we speak about it often. If nothing else, you know in our church, at least once a month on Communion Sunday, we're going to talk about repentance, and then probably three or four times after that. We believe in the biblical principle of repentance. We don't see it as just a small piece of the gospel. We see it as a central point of the message of Jesus. This idea of repentance that is woven from Genesis all through the Old Testament, all throughout the teachings of Jesus, and all throughout the writings of the apostles, repentance is there over and over and over again. And repentance simply means, it's a simple word, all that it means is to change one's mind and change direction. That's what repentance means. It's this idea that I see that I am doing something wrong that is leading to these consequences. I need to change the way I see that thing. I need to change the way I see myself, and I need to turn directions accordingly. I need to change the direction. You know, last week, my wife and I, we joked because she said that I put my dog on blast last week because I told the whole congregation that my dog is terrible. And she was like, you can't go telling your dog. And you know, we love my dog, but he is terrible. We're working with him. He's got this thing. Some of you may have found this. He's only like 6 months, so I've got to like remember that he's just a puppy. But he's got this thing where he's like great from the moment he wakes up. And then at like 6 p.m., he turns into like a nightmare. Like from like 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock, he's just a totally different dog. I mean, he bites, he screams, he barks. He sleeps fine, but getting him to sleep, that's the whole thing. Last night, you know, I knew I had to be here early this morning. He did not want to go to bed. I mean, he was biting the bed. He was eating everything. I was like, Lynn, you got to throw this dog out the window. This is not good. But what we're doing is we're in that process of trying to help him understand that this behavior you're doing is not getting you your desired result. And so we're trying to get him to see things differently and then turn direction accordingly. And obviously that's just a simple example, but that's this biblical principle of seeing where we're heading and seeing that it is destructive and seeing that our sinful ways are getting us nowhere and turning and changing the way we see ourselves, the way we see the world around us, the way we see God, and then changing direction. Not just simply kind of removing it from our lives, but running away from it. You know, that's this biblical principle. And as you begin to read through about repentance throughout the Bible, it always, in almost every single instance that the word repentance comes up, it is talking about us walking away from our sin. Almost every time. Every time it is building this idea that you and I, apart from God, are sinful, broken people. That, you know, and that's becoming unpopular to say. But that is right from the book of Romans. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. The Bible from Genesis to Revelation is proclaiming that all of us have fallen from God. That all of us, from our own free will, have continued the pattern of the Garden of Eden and have chosen to redefine good and evil for ourselves. And have chosen to be God unto ourselves rather than submit to the authority of God. And we have walked away from Him. We have committed true rebellion against the kingdom of God. And on our own, we are hopeless. We are guilty. We stand condemned before God. And repentance is this moment. It's this process in our lives of recognizing our fallen state and then changing how we see it. Changing how we see that sinful lifestyle, changing how we see God, changing how we see, and then turning accordingly. And rather than pursuing the things of old, we begin to pursue the things of God and righteousness and holiness. That's this idea that is woven throughout the scriptures. You know, we read this last week in Pastor Joe's message, but in Matthew 4, Jesus begins his ministry with these words, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." Before he ever gave us some of the most classic teachings and sermons, he came and he set the standard. He said, I'm going to begin by telling you, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus was giving his audience from the beginning that repentance was at the center of this wonderful gospel message. And he went even further. Later on in Luke 5, verse 32, he said this, I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus did not come preaching a message that we are good people. He did not come preaching a message that we just need a little bit of religion and that we just need to kind of modify some of our behaviors. He came saying, we are sinners. We are in need of the grace and mercy of God, and that it begins with a heart of repentance. It begins with us seeing our sin and seeing ourselves for who we are in the eyes of a holy God, changing how we see it, and turning to a life serving the King and serving within the kingdom of God. One of the greatest evangelist preachers that ever lived, Charles Spurgeon, he once said this. He said, "Repentance is a discovery of the evil of sin and mourning that we have ever committed it, a resolution to forsake it. It is, in fact, a change of mind of a very deep and practical character which makes the man love what he once hated and hate what he once loved." You know, repentance is not just casually being sorry for the things I've done wrong. It's not coming to God and just saying, "I'm sorry for what I did. I'll never do it again." It's not just coming to God and saying, "You know, I'm sorry," and all we want is God to restore our reputation. It isn't coming to God and saying, "Look, God, of all that I've lost, I promise I'll just never go back. Just forgive me and restore everything." No, it is being broken for our sin. It is being grieved. It is being, you know, crushed by the weight of what we have done and realizing not only what it has done to our life, that's the least, but what it has done to the heart of God, what it has done to others, how our sin has been a part of the evil that is destroying the very creation that God has given us. If you were here, you'll remember that back right before Easter, Pastor Kurt led us in a powerful series on the atonement. And basically, the first two messages of that series were walking through the depth of our sin. You know, and that's something you will not hear in many other churches, and you should be thankful that we do. I know sometimes, you know, it's easy in our services to just come like feeling, wow, it's just, where's all the celebration? Well, the celebration is that we are understanding that our grace, that the grace of God has come to rescue us from that sin. That's why we celebrate. And sometimes we have to understand the depth of our sin to understand the greatness of the love and the mercy of Jesus. I've often felt that if you don't understand how the depth of your sin and how absolutely wicked it is, you'll never be able to appreciate the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You know, and so this idea of repentance is just all throughout the scriptures. We can't avoid it. And it's meant to show us that there should be a brokenness about our sin, a grieving of our sin. But what's powerful, and what I want everyone to hear, because I know that at the moment you begin to talk about repentance, it's easy to just be like, to start feeling guilt and to start feeling, and part of that is true. There should be a brokenness. But repentance isn't just there to make us feel guilty. Repentance is also a way that God uses to bring freedom in our lives. That repentance is the beginning of great freedom and healing and restoration and the beginning of a great relationship with Jesus. Paul says this, if you want to turn there, in 2 Corinthians 7. And just to kind of give the backstory here for a minute, and if you remember in the book of 1 Corinthians, the very first letter he wrote to this church, most of that letter was actually him kind of correcting the church. Most of that letter was more disciplinary in nature. It was Paul calling out the Corinthian church for their hypocrisy. It was him calling out for them making a bad name of Jesus in their world and using this great gospel for their own pleasure and for their own gain. And in 2 Corinthians, he is writing to commend them because they listened. They saw the error of their ways, they saw their sinfulness, and they were broken over it. In fact, what he's going to say is that they were grieved over it. And he's writing to commend them, that they didn't just hear Paul's words, and more so God's words, and then just kind of cavalierly say, "I'm sorry." But they were broken, and it led to healing, and it led to restoration. He says this in verse 10. He says, "For godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death." He says, this godly grief, this true, genuine brokenness over your sin and over what you've done to the heart of God, he said, that, even though it hurts, even though it stings, even though it's difficult, that is what will lead to repentance. And that is what will lead to your salvation. That is what brings healing. That brokenness, you're not just meant to live that way forever, but it is the starting point of finding this relationship with Jesus and being reconciled to him. And he goes even further to say, but that godly grief, that I'm sorry, let's just make it up, let's make everything fine, and then you go back to it. Or that godly grief that is just more concerned with me getting out of trouble or getting everything back that I lost. That kind of grief, that leads to death. That leads us away from the presence of God. But true brokenness over our sin, there's freedom. There's hope in that. It's not something to be feared. It's something to be pursued every single day. But he goes even further, and he says this. He says, foresee what earnestness this godly grief has produced in you. He says, look how much it transformed you. And he even goes and he says, but what eagerness for the gospel, for ministry, and eagerness to clear yourself of that sin. What indignation over the sin of the past. What fear of ever going back to that sin and losing the presence of God. What longing for more of his presence. What zeal for his kingdom. What punishment. And at every point, you have proven yourselves innocent in this matter. He says, that repentance that you guys went through, look how it changed you. Look how it transformed you. Look what it has done in your church. Look what it has done in your lives. Look what it has done in your community. It wasn't just about you feeling guilty, but it was about God bringing about freedom and healing in your life. And see, it's easy sometimes when we talk about repentance, when we hear repentance, we want to push back from it because, you know what? It does sting a little bit. It does hurt when we are exposed before a holy God of who we are without him and the depth of our sin. But when God calls us to repentance, it's also a call to come and find life. It's also a call to leave behind the things that bring about death and find great life, mercy, grace, and healing in the name of Jesus. Repentance is not something that we are to fear. It is something that brings about hope each and every day in our lives. That's powerful. And that's what repentance is all about. And it's a central part of the message of Jesus. It wasn't just this fringe part. It was a central piece of what Jesus came to teach. And this is what is missing from so many people's stories. And not just these stories that I'm talking about that I've read or that I've watched or that you've listened to, but I'm fearful that it's a part of the story that we have never experienced, something that we've never walked through, that for some of us, maybe our faith has been defined more by the fact that we grew up in church than that we ever began to follow Jesus, that maybe our faith has been more defined by doing things that Christians are supposed to do, but it hasn't been defined by a moment of true repentance that led us into a life-giving relationship with Jesus. When you listen to these stories, you'll never hear, well, yeah, there was one time that I felt the depth of my sin. You'll never hear that they ever felt. In fact, for many people, the reason that they walk away from the faith is they can't even imagine the idea that they might be a sinner. They can't imagine the idea that the way they live might be unholy. They can't imagine that we're actually fallen people. And so the idea of repentance is completely lost. You know, for many people, and I actually listened to an interview this past week, they were sitting in their church, and it was when their pastor began talking about repentance, that's when they left. They said, I'm good as long as God is watching over me. I'm good as long as God is taking care of me. I'm good as long as this church is about just making a difference in the world and taking care of this and helping me be a better husband and helping me be a better spouse. But the moment you start telling me I have to change, the moment you start telling me that my life might actually be sinful, I want nothing to do with your gospel. And that's one of the main reasons that people are walking away from faith is they are too prideful, too selfish to see that we might actually not be as good as we think we are. That maybe Paul was right when he said we are all sinners and have all fallen short of the glory of God. And that is why Jesus has called us to repentance. Not so that he can sit and point the finger at us and make us feel guilty, but so that we can find freedom in him. You know what I think some of the most powerful words, and these aren't even in the notes, I'm just, so I don't have the reference right off the top of my head, but Google it, it's there, I promise. But it says, therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You know what? Apart from Jesus, there is guilt, and there is shame, and there is condemnation, but in Him, there is hope, and there is freedom. We are not meant to just live in this guilty state forever. And sometimes we have this image of repentance that every day I'm supposed to wake up and just be so, like, feeling guilty about who I am. You're not getting the whole part of the message. The repentance, the brokenness leads us to this freeing, wonderful, glorious relationship with Jesus where there is no condemnation, but there is this wonderful experience with my Savior, with what He has done for all of us. And I want to read very quickly one of the most famous stories that Jesus ever told. In fact, if you're here and maybe you're new to church or you know you're just kind of exploring Christianity, there's a good chance you've heard this story before. And it's the story of the prodigal son. It's an amazing story. If you want to open there, this is in Luke chapter 15. We're going to read the story in its entirety, but we're just going to kind of focus on a piece of the story just for today. But I love this story because I can't think of maybe a better illustration that Jesus ever gave us of what repentance looks like in our lives. Jesus said this in Luke chapter 15, starting at verse 11. He said, "There was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me.' And he divided his property between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property on reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. And he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. And no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring the fattened calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. And he was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate." Now, I love this story, and there is so many pieces of this story that we could unpackage, but I just want to focus on just kind of the center part of the story. You know, we get this image of this son who is meant to represent every one of us, who had everything, who had the protection of his father, that had the blessing of his father, but decided that it wasn't enough, decided that he knew better, and went off on his own. And he had his day in the sun. He had his moment of pleasure, but ultimately it brought him to a place of complete hopelessness and desperation. When I read that illustration of this son sitting in the mud with the pigs, eating the food that they ate, I just think to myself, I know that there's no human illustration that can fully grasp what it means to be separated from God, but that's a pretty good start. Just this idea of complete hopelessness, lost, alone, abandoned. Without Jesus, that's who we are. Without Jesus, we are lost. We are without hope. We are nothing without Him. But what I love about the story is it says that in that state, it says He came to himself. He came. In fact, some of the definitions say he came to his senses. There began to be a change. He began to see the situation differently. He began to see himself differently. And he cries out into that moment. He says, "What have I done?" He says, "When I was with my father, I had need of nothing. I was in perfect relationship with my father. But now look what I have done. Look what it has done. You know, and the one thing I really love is that he realizes how good it was to be in relationship with his father. He realizes just how good it was to be under the authority of his father, because he realized something that I believe all of us need to realize too, and that is the greatest gift was not what his father could give him. The greatest gift was his father. His father was the gift. You know, I heard a pastor say this a couple of months ago, and it's just resonated with me, and it's challenged me. He asked his church, and he said, listen, I know that none of you would actually answer, you know, no to this or yes to this question, but he said, I want to ask you something just in your own heart. If God came to you today and promised you that for the rest of your life, everything was going to be good, that there would be blessings, that there would be success, that everything would be fine, and then he promised you heaven for all of eternity, all of its glory, all of its splendor, everything that heaven is yours. The only difference is that I won't be there. He says, how many of you would take that deal? He says, listen, I know none of you would actually out loud say yes, but I want you to think about it. If God is offering you all of that, would you take it? And he let that sit for a moment, and he looked and said, if you say yes to that question, you've missed the point of the gospel. He said, heaven is not the gift. The greatest gift is we get God. That's what Jesus has come to restore. Like, Jesus didn't come just so that we could go to heaven one day. Heaven would be nothing if it wasn't for God. He is the gift. And that's what this son realized in that moment, is that the real gift, the thing that I gave up, was God. In his case, the Father, but the Father represents God in our lives. And I love what he says. He says, I'm going to go back to my Father. And he says, I'm going to say that I have sinned before heaven and before you. He doesn't just say, listen, I know I've done wrong to you, Dad. But he says, I realize that what I've done is an assault against God himself. That my selfishness, my pride, my sin is actually rebellion against the very kingdom of God. And see, for many of us, we never get that far. We see maybe how it affects those around us, and we see our sin as just maybe humanly significant. But our sin is heavenly significant. Our sin has broken the very heart of God. And that is where we have to focus, that we have not only sinned against other people, but we have sinned against God. And I love, you know, you just fast forward that story, because in that state of humility, he comes before his father, he falls down before him, and he begins that statement. He says, Father, I have sinned against you, I have sinned against heaven, I'm not worthy to be called your son. And you just kind of get this image of the father, like the son is trying to say all of this, and the father just like is kind of ignoring him. He's kind of like talking over him, get the ring, get the robe. And it's just, what an image of what the grace of God is all about. What an image that even in our sinful state, Romans say? While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That the love of Christ has been there all along. We never had to go searching for the love of God. It was always there. But what's powerful about this story, and what we can't miss, the love of God was never in question. The hope of Jesus was never in question. But the only way that reconciliation was possible was through a heart of repentance. That was the starting point. That was the message, is that the Father never stopped loving his Son, that the promise of hope and eternity was always there. But it began with a moment of humility and a moment of repentance that could lead back into that season of reconciliation, that could lead into being reunited with his Father. And that is what repentance is about in our lives. The grace of God has always been there. The love of God has always been there. But the relationship can only be restored through seasons and the process of repentance. Through you and I being broken over our sin and coming to grips with what it has done, not just to our lives, and not even just to those around us, but also to the very heart of God. And in that, then reconciliation can begin. Then that relationship with Christ, with God, can be restored. That can lead us into freedom that we spoke of earlier. And that's at the center of this gospel message. And that's what so many of us, I wonder, and listen, I hope you know this. This is something I'm examining my heart every single day. That's why I love when we take communion as a church. We don't just dive into communion, but we take time and say, examine our hearts. Where do we stand before God? And Pastor Kurt, he mentioned this, you know, during our worship time. Repentance is not like a one-time event. It's not just like a moment. It's a process. And it's something that leads us forward day in and day out. There should be in our lives a constant state of examining our heart before the Lord. There should always be a brokenness over the sin and a desire to be reconciled with God and to come back and find that grace and mercy to continue forward day in and day out. And listen, I don't want to, you know, I never want to come up here and say anything that I feel could offend or hurt because, listen, I would never claim whether someone is saved or not saved. That is ultimately between you and the Lord, but it scares me. You know, sometimes, like, you know, when we're doing water baptisms and we interview people and we ask them to share their testimony, or just in passing, when I ask people to share, you know, what has Jesus done in your life and what does it mean to you to be a follower of Jesus? Inevitably, you hear answers, and not just in our church, this is everywhere, but you hear answers like, well, I've just always been a Christian and I just want to be baptized because I know it'll bring me closer to God. And with as much love, I want to hold them and say, no one has always been a Christian. No one. And just being in church or having a family that was saved doesn't do anything. It's a relationship with Jesus that begins with repentance. It's a relationship with Jesus that has transformed your life. That's what brings you into that relationship. Or you'll hear stories of, you know, I just want to be baptized because I want to set a better example for my kids. Or I feel like it'll make me a better husband or a better father or a better, you know, spouse. And guess what? I believe Jesus can help you with those things. But that's not what salvation is all about. That's not what Jesus came to accomplish. Jesus came to transform us. Jesus came to show us the guilt in our lives so that in that we would cry out for mercy and grace and be restored. Or you hear of people that say, you know, I'm coming to be baptized, or their testimony is, I was going through a struggle in my life, and I found my way to church, and I began to pray, and I began to read the Bible, and I felt better and things. And guess what? I'm glad you did, and I believe you can. But that's not what Jesus came to accomplish. Jesus came not to make bad people good. He came to make lost people saved. He came to transform us. And that begins through seasons and processes of repentance, of being broken over our sin. And if your faith has been more defined by just doing what Christians do, then you're missing the central piece of the gospel. This is why Jesus said that one day people are going to come to him and say, Lord, Lord, did I not do all of these things for your kingdom? And he's going to say, depart from me. I never knew you. Because the faith was not just about doing Christian things. It was about being a follower of Jesus. It was about being in relationship with Jesus that begins with a season of repentance, begins with moments and processes of repentance. Now, I want to share very quickly as we close, and the band, they're going to come forward now. But I want to read just one more story, a short one this time, one that Jesus shared just a few chapters later, after the prodigal son. And this is in Luke chapter 18. The prodigal son shows us, I think, a lot of repentance at work in our lives. But this story, I think, shows us really the posture of repentance. And Jesus said this in Luke 18. He said, two men went up into the temple to pray. One a Pharisee, and one a tax collector. And the Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed like this, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all that I get, but the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift his eyes to heaven, but he beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful on me, for I am a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. Now, we could talk a whole lot about the Pharisee in this story, but I just want to talk about the tax collector for a moment. It is amazing that the tax collector was even in the temple. In his day, there was no one that was seen as a greater sinner than the tax collector. In fact, most of the time, they weren't even welcome in the temple. So the very fact that he was there is incredible. But what does it say about him? It says that he was far off. He was embarrassed. He was ashamed. He couldn't even bring himself to be around with everyone else. It says that he was so overwhelmed with his sin that he couldn't even look to heaven. And it says that he was so grieved, so broken, that all he could do was beat his chest. And I don't think it was meant to be like this was a show. I don't think repentance is about putting on some kind of display. But I think that all of this is showing that repentance is not just being, I'm sorry. It's about true brokenness before God. Truly recognizing what we have done to the heart of God and how it has affected others. And in that moment, all he could do, he couldn't say a long prayer. All he could say was, God, have mercy on me, for I'm a sinner. That's all he could say. He didn't come to God and do what I think a lot of us, and I know I've done this. He didn't come to God and try to ask for forgiveness, but convince God that his sin wasn't that bad. He didn't come to God trying to convince himself that his sin wasn't that bad. He recognized, I am a sinner, and my only hope is that God would have mercy upon me. That's the posture of repentance. It's not coming to God to get a bunch of things from him or for him to just snap his fingers and make everything better. It's about being reconciled with him. It's about making right what has been made wrong through our sin. Pastor Kurt, he shares this often, a lot of times during our seasons of prayer and fasting. And I've always, it's stuck with me. He says, one of the most interesting and maybe ironic things about our faith is that when we sin, and when we're in that season of brokenness, sometimes the last thing we want to do is come before God. But there's also nowhere else we can go. Because where else will I find mercy? Where else will I find freedom and forgiveness but in the arms of Jesus? And see, that's the message, and I hope everyone hears this today. This isn't a message meant for us to just walk away feeling guilty. Listen, there is a point to that. Paul said it earlier, godly grief, godly brokenness, that's what leads us to repentance. But that's only part of the story. The other part is that we serve a God who wants to be merciful. We don't serve a God. That was in the Atonement series as well. We serve a God who longs to be merciful. He's just waiting for hearts that are repentant before him and that are willing to own up to who we are, but then in that come before him and say, Lord, have mercy so that I may find freedom and hope in his name. And that to me is what repentance is all about throughout Scripture. And yes, it's difficult. And yes, it's hard. And it's uncomfortable. And it stings and it prods us and it pushes against our pride and it pushes against all that we feel. But it's those things that will push us into the freedom that is found in Jesus. The last verse I want to share, and I know, I'm sorry, I'm at that 10:30 mark, but we're going to just close in prayer here in just a moment. In 1 Corinthians chapter number 1, Paul says this, and this might seem a little strange, but just bear with me for a moment. He says this in 1 Corinthians 1:23. He says, but we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block and unto the Greeks foolishness. But to those who are being called, being saved, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God. I share that because we will have and always will preach Jesus crucified. We preach the cross of Jesus Christ as the only hope for mankind. And the message of the cross hurts. The message of the cross is uncomfortable. Because the cross, when we see Jesus and what he went through for us, it shows us how ugly our sin is. It reveals to us the depth of our transgressions before God. But it also reveals that he is and will always be our only hope. This Savior that came and gave his life in my place so that I would have a chance of hope and salvation in this life. And I share that because there is a movement within, and I use quotation marks, within Christianity because I believe it's false faith, but there's a growing movement with millions upon millions upon millions of followers that is doing everything it can to shave down the rough edges of our faith, that is trying to shave down the sharp edges that bring power to our faith. My wife will attest to this. Over the Easter season, I watched a video that had almost 10 million watches and views. And this pastor, a pastor at a church, was telling his congregation that if anyone tells you that Jesus died for your sins, you need to run away from that church. That if anyone tells you that Jesus died for your sins, that's evil and that's wrong. He says Jesus just died to show us what happens when you fight the system. That Jesus just died to show us what happens when you fight against religion. He says, you are good people that did not need saving. And my wife will tell you, she found me crying in our apartment. Because our gospel is so much better than that. This gospel has hope. This gospel has freedom. And Jesus might have died at the hands of power. But the Bible makes it clear he died to be a ransom for many so that we could be reconciled to God. That's what the cross is about. And it's the rough edges of our faith that give it power. And if you get rid of that, there's no power any longer. So that's what I want to leave us with today. Have we found ourselves in that posture of repentance? If you've been in faith for a long time, I hope that what today does is it just makes you once again just examine your heart and ask the Lord, where do I stand before you? Have I gotten lax? Have I allowed my faith to be more just about what I do, not about who I know? Let it be a time of celebration, of reminding what God has brought us out of. You know, it's always good every once in a while to remember who you were before Jesus showed up, so that you can celebrate where he has brought you. As we sang about it earlier, celebrate that he took your grave and made it a garden. And if you don't know Christ as your Savior, or maybe after today you're wondering, where do I stand? I hope that today does not leave you feeling condemned, but it leaves you knowing that through repentance, there is freedom. There is hope in Jesus' name. Would everyone just stand here today? We're just going to close this in prayer. And I just encourage you today, as we pray, make your seat your altar. And what I encourage is that if today, you know, when we close, if you do not know Christ as your Savior, if you have not yet entered into this wonderful, life-giving, transformative relationship with Jesus Christ, you cry out to him right where you are. But we would ask that after service is over, I will be here. Some of our leaders will be here. My wife will be here. We would love to talk with you, and we would love to pray with you, because there is no greater decision than the decision to follow Jesus, and that there is no healing for our souls than what he accomplished at the cross and the empty tomb. And so as I pray, I just encourage you, ask the Lord to search you. And if that's you today, I would encourage you to come forward after the service is over, and we'd love to pray. If you're here and maybe the idea of coming forward is a little intimidating, I understand. But if you look in the seat back in front of you, there is a Connect card, and if you fill that out at the bottom, you can check a box that says, I would like to learn more about Jesus. And I would love to be the one to give you a call this week and talk to you about this amazing Savior that we have. So Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, from the beginning of this service to now, it is clear that you are here and you are drawing us to you. And my greatest prayer is that today none of us would leave feeling condemned, but rather know that there is hope found in Jesus Christ. Our faith is not one that is just about telling people that they're sinners. It's about telling them that there is hope for the sinner through Jesus Christ. And Lord, my greatest prayer is that if anyone here does not know you as their Savior, that today would be that day of salvation, that your grace would come upon each and every one of us and draw us to you, draw us back to you. Lord, we are thankful for our church. And every day we want to be obedient with what it means to be the church. We want to worship. We want to fellowship and gather together. We want to serve your kingdom. We want to reach this world. But when it's all said and done, when we meet you face to face, what matters is did we have a relationship with you? And my prayer is that all of us, today and in this next season of our church, would enter in to a true life-giving relationship with you. For the first time, or maybe for some of us, we need to come back to that. Lord, I believe you have so much for our church, and we're just believing that today, next Sunday, the Sundays after, we're going to weekly see your presence moving among us. And we believe that this next year is going to be marked by salvation. My salvation in this community. Even starting next Saturday at the Day of Hope, Lord, we've got a prayer tent for a reason. It is there because we want to lead people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. And I pray that next Sunday, when we get up and we give the testimony of the day, that part of that testimony would be the souls that were won for the kingdom of God. We thank you for this. We pray you be with us all this week. Watch over us and protect us. We pray for our children who are meeting in the other building. We ask that they had a wonderful service and that you'd be with them this week. Lord, we do not believe church is just for the adults. It is for our kids. And we pray that at their early age, they too would encounter the living God. We thank you for it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you all again. God bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful week.